but other ancillary issues around it, including whether you are entitled to an appointee of Mr. President as the Federal Minister of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, your rights relating to your land, and several issues. I have tried in my little spare time to do some studies on it, but I have not been privileged to have one brief on that particular issue, so I didn't want to labor my head too much on it. But I know that the issues are very germane and are biting to the indigents, and I think that a holistic approach to it, preferably from the legislative angle, can best solve the problems. Senator, distinguished Senator Saidamu, I'm sorry if I don't get the name right, you raised the issue of plea bargain. So I, in my experience, had difficulty in buying into plea bargain because it was not expressly codified before. But recently, as at 15th of May 2015, by one of the last legislatures that these hallowed chambers of the 7th Assembly made, the Criminal Administration Justice Act, have codified expressly how plea bargain can work. It has stated the circumstances where the plea bargain can be proposed. It has provided who initiates plea bargain. It has provided when a person, a suspect, an accused person, initiates plea bargain, what are the consequences? It means clearly that he is not contesting the criminality that he has been alleged. Then what are the terms for the bargain? How does negotiation go? And when the negotiation go, to what extent can it affect the punishment that will be meted? And even when they have agreed on those terms, does the judge have discretion in the award of the punishment that both the prosecution and the accused have agreed upon? Is there in, I think, section 270 of the Criminal Administration Act of 2015? I think on that level, we can proceed. Whether we should abolish it, I don't think so. I don't think we should abolish it, because it is very possible that someone who had the privilege to hold money, property, in trust, and had breached that trust, and later on changes his mind and said, I'm sorry for what I did, I want to return a chunk of these proceeds, he should be allowed to. It doesn't prevent him from being convicted, but it solves the entire riddle of the 12 years, 15 years of criminal trial. And the state does not get a refund of what they want. And even when they get, it will take more than 20 years. Some of the cases in relation to Abacha loot are still hanging on in some areas, which a plea bargain could sort them out as quickly as possible. So I think plea bargain should be encouraged instead of being abolished. You raised the issue about the workload in Supreme Court. Honestly speaking, I sympathize with the distinguished judges and justices of the Supreme Court. Those men are working beyond their age. Few months ago, at the international airport, I ran into the immediate Justice Dahiru Mustafa, the former Chief Justice of Nigeria, at the airport, and I couldn't recognize him. He was looking younger, he was fresh, he was strong, smart, carrying his briefcase by himself, and I went to halt him to help him out. And I said, my lord, what's the magic? Few months ago, you were looking so old, and all of a sudden now, the wrinkles are disappearing. And he said, what we go through in Supreme Court is torturous and unbearable. I totally agree that the jurisdiction of Supreme Court is too wide. There are very few countries who ever try what we're doing now. In fact, we're very lucky that many of them are not dying on the seat. I think that, you know, your distinguished senators, you will recollect that in the last attempt to amend the Constitution, the issue of their jurisdiction was part of what was produced and presented before the relevant committees for consideration. Till tomorrow, I know their thinking. Many of them are not happy that the distinguished senators and members of House of Rep did not approve one reduction of their jurisdiction. They are overburdened. I was in court not too long ago, and matter touching on divorce, which ought to be matter for customary court or an area court, and maybe stop at upper area court or at best high court, came as far as Supreme Court, and they are quarreling over who should have custody of a child. And before that case got to Supreme Court, it must have taken 15, 20 years. And yet, they are in Supreme Court for it. Their lordships were visibly complaining. And I'm sure that the distinguished senators in the hallowed red chambers can bring a solution to that issue. Their jurisdiction is too wide. We need to reduce it drastically. In other climes, other countries, some Supreme Court have 15 cases for the whole year. And they take time to go to town, go to various jurisdictions, and do robust research. When they come out with their judgments, they are not only just judgments, they are policy statements. They are like other laws made, which can be cited and for education, for learning in school. One judgment from Supreme Court can constitute a course for students in the law school, either in the university or of the faculty of law, but not the way we are doing now. They have to summarize their judgments and be as brief as possible, and it's telling on their health. I think we need to come to the aid of Supreme Court. If I have the privilege to hold the office that can bring solution to it, it will be one of the quickest steps I will take to ensure that we do something to their jurisdiction. Senator, you wanted also to know one of the complex cases that I may have done in the past. With every sense of modesty, I have done quite a lot. I'm a litigation lawyer. Solicitor's job are done by my juniors. I only do vetting once in a while. Litigation is my core strength. And so I'm in court every day. Tomorrow I will be in another court. So it's difficult for me to pick one. But let me look at the latest one that recently we had one in Kogi State High Court. It's a high court matter, but it's a very unique judgment. And for such judgments, I desire that they are tested on appeal so that the veracity of it can either be affirmed or overturned, and then you go to Supreme Court and get their opinion. Here was a local state where local government elections were to be conducted. The opposing parties, that is parties who were not in power in the state, clamored for the election to take place. And eventually, they agreed to take place. And when they agreed, they didn't follow the basic rules of the game. No publication as to the venues where the polling units will be. No publication as to names of candidates and names of would-be voters to know where they are supposed to vote, so that on the appropriate day you can go to that place to go and vote. And something was hurried up, a charade, called an election, and they were sworn in. And I chose to take the matter to court personally on my own special strength and score. That time, merger had not taken place. So the ACN, the AMPP, the CPC were operating on their own. So I sought the permission of the three parties, leadership of the three parties in the state, to take up an action on their behalf and in their name, at no cost to them. At that time, I was already a member of the CPC, so I could make sacrifices for them. So I took it up in court and filed reliefs, seeking how to nullify that election. But I knew that if we go to the election petition,